Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to St. Andrew Baptist Church this morning. If you are in person or online watching, I can see you through the camera. You might be in your pajamas, but it's okay. You are still here to worship the Lord. In fact, I'd like to honor and commend you just for doing that. I mean, I know that sometimes in times of great distress, church attendance and praising God can be a thing that's kind of thrown the way. So I'd like to honor and commend you for just sticking to it. Well, it's a great morning to praise the Lord. We're going to praise and sing songs to his name. We're going to hear the word proclaimed, and we're going to leave change for the better and just encourage to go share the gospel. So let's go ahead and stand and let's sing about Jesus being the way, the truth, and the life. To every heartbreak, to every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress. You are my portion. You are my hiding place. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are. Let us give thanks. Let us praise his name this morning. sing, "You give life, you give love."
You give life, you are loved, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
We're not singing, you give life.
You give life, you are loved, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord.
It's your breath.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
All the earth will shout your praise.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
Sing again, all the earth.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Gives us life. It is his breath in our lungs. And that is why we praise him this morning. He's a great God. And then you go. Sorry, my apologies. Let's go ahead and stand up again. For this last song, we sung that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And we've sung of the life-giving power that he has for us. Now let us sing that because he lives, we can face tomorrow. Let's sing together.
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. And empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear.
Amen. Thank you, Tim, praise team, for leading us today in a wonderful time of worship. So good to see you. It is every Sunday morning just a delight to see you, get to chat for just a brief amount of time, but just being together in the Lord is good. Amen? Amen. Our youth are out today. On their fall retreat, 62 young people and their adult workers, so pray for them. They are having a good retreat already. They are studying the text, "If the Son sets you free, you shall be free indeed." Isn't that a marvelous word? And of course, our young people, our children, in the midst of this pandemic and all that has happened, they have a lot of things, you know, that tempt to bind them up. And in Christ, they can be set free. So it's an important time for them. So you be praying. Let me say just one one word, one sentence really, about our election. Folks, from whatever perspective you may come, one of the things all of us, at least as believers, should be able to agree to do is to pray for God to cause justice and righteousness to prevail. You know, I mean, whatever side you're on, we ought to be able to pray for that, amen, as believers. And so I just invite you to join with me in that prayer, that we would just ask God to so work in our country. We know how much we need God's hand working in our country. Pray for righteousness and justice to prevail just in everything that's happening, and to bring it to his appointed conclusion. Now, last week, we read Jesus' statement as we were looking at the faithfulness of our Lord Jesus. We read the statement that I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now, I will tell you, last week I came prepared to preach that entire message to you. And I only got a third of the way through it, because I just sensed the Spirit leading me to dwell in some other parts of the passage that we read. I needed it. I thought others needed it, because it's a passage filled with wonderful, wonderful promise. And so today I'm going to finish that task, all right? I'm going to finish preaching on the way, the truth, and the life. So let's begin by rereading the entirety of that passage in John 14, 1-7. Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also." And Thomas said, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known the Father also. From now on, you know him and have seen him." Now, for the sake of continuity, I want us to recall some of the ways, can't say all the ways, some of the ways that Jesus is the way, just to be reminded as a foundation for the truth and the life. Jesus is the way to heaven. He is the way to forgiveness. He's the way to lives filled with righteousness. And he is the way to successful living. Folks, let me tell you, there is no life with greater purpose. There is no life with greater success. There is no life with greater joy than the life that you have when you're following the Lord Jesus. And if you want to disrupt that life, even if you've come to Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life, you've come to him and you've trusted him and you've begun to follow him. If you begin to deviate from that way, you lose some of that joy. You lose some of that success. You lose some of that purpose that you have in life. He is not only the way to eternal life, he is the way to abundant life. And when we talk about life, we're going to talk in detail a bit more about that this morning. But Jesus is the way and the only way. No one comes to the Father. No one has this life except through him, Jesus is the way not only to eternal life, but to successful living. And Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the living word. He's the living truth. Remember two verses. I'm sure most of you know them, but I want to bring them right here to the forefront of our mind in John chapter 1. John begins his gospel by saying, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." And he continues to talk about the Word, and then in verse 14, he says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." Jesus is the living Word. He is the truth made alive. And Jesus himself, when he was praying for us, praying for believers that would come later after the apostles, he prayed, "Father, sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth." Excuse me. So the living word said, the word, the Bible, is truth. And my friend, the focus of the written word, the focus of this book, the Bible, is Jesus. The focus of the written word is the living word. The books of the law foreshadow him. The books of history reveal our need for him. The books of song and of poetry help us to worship him. The books of prophecy declare both his first coming and his second coming. The Gospels tell us about his life, his death, his resurrection. The Acts chronicle the difference that is made in the life of those who will follow Jesus. The letters extol his majesty, and they teach his followers how to take the character of Christ and see their own character molded and remade and shaped to be like the Lord Jesus. And then the revelation comforts us, and it gives us the certainty that Jesus is coming again to establish his kingdom and righteousness and justice upon the earth, and warns us to live ready for that coming. Folks, the whole of the Bible is wholly about Jesus. And I want to slow down just a minute, just to illustrate that at a few points for us to understand. It's important for us to know that because Jesus is the truth, that he points us to the written truth to understand him and to understand his ways. When we say the focus of the written word is the living word, we talk about the books of the law that foreshadow him. We're talking about things, for instance, on the Day of Atonement. And you probably remember that on that day, the high priest stripped himself of his royal garments as high priest and just dressed only in the pure white linen of the priest. And he came and he washed himself and cleansed himself. And he took blood twice, once the blood of a bull for his own sin, and secondly, the blood of a goat for the sin of his people. And twice on that day only, he went into the Holy of Holies behind the veil, and there he sprinkled the blood upon the mercy seat, and then he sprinkled the blood seven times upon the ground to make atonement for his sin and for the sin of his people. And that happened every year on that very special day of the year. But all of that was just to foreshadow. It was just to give an advanced picture of what the Lord Jesus would do. When you remember after Jesus rose from the dead, And Mary approached him, finally recognizing that he wasn't just the gardener there, but recognized his voice and said, "Lord," and she went to embrace him, and he would not let her at that point. And he said, "Because I go to the Father." And after that point, Jesus went back up into to heaven for a brief time, into the heavenly holy of holies, there before the throne of God. And Hebrews tells us that there he offered not the blood of bulls and goats, but his own blood in order to pay the ransom price for each of us. Because by his death and the shedding of his blood, he had paid the penalty for our sins, and he offered that blood there as a sacrifice to his Father, securing our eternal redemption. The books of history reveal our need for him. You remember the pattern in the Judges? How God had given the people the victory to go in and to take the promised land, had given them success, and they had conquered the land. They had not fully obeyed him, and they had left some of the pagan people still living in the land, much to their own trouble and dismay. But God had nonetheless given them victory, and for a while they followed the Lord and obeyed the Lord. But then they would begin to mix it up with their neighbors. I had a religion professor when I was in college. She used to describe this. She said they would begin to talk across the clothesline to one another. Now, some of y'all remember what that's like. Amen? Today we have to meet by the dryer, you know. but they began to mix it up with their neighbors. Now, there wasn't anything wrong with them mixing it up with their neighbors for the point of conversation and for caring. They were to be a priestly nation in order to bring their neighbors to know the one true and living God. But sadly, it went the other way. And they began to do the things that their neighbors did, and they began to fall into all kinds of sin and wickedness, and ultimately into idolatry and following after their neighbors' false gods. And then God would have to release chastisement upon them, and they would fall under the power of some foreign force. And not until they repented and cried out to God, God then would raise up a deliverer, a judge. And the judge, by the power of God, would deliver the people. And they would repent, and they would come back to God, and they would follow the Lord for a season. And then, in another generation, they would start mixing it up with their neighbors and taking on their neighbors' ways and following after their neighbors' gods. And God would have to send chastisement. They would fall into a captivity and oppression. And God would raise up a judge when they repented and deliver their people all over and over and over again. What's the Lord teaching us? Folks, the Lord is teaching us that when we come to the way, the truth, and the life, that we need to be steady in following the Lord. And if we don't follow the Lord, if instead of leading our neighbors to know Christ, if instead of helping our neighbors to follow the Lord, we start following our neighbors, and we start living like they live, and we start walking in the ways of wickedness and unrighteousness like they do, what will happen? God will bring us into a period of chastisement, not as punishment. For Christ has already paid our punishment upon the cross. But as chastisement to bring us back to walk faithfully with him again. And then the books of song and poetry help us to worship him and comfort our souls. For instance, Psalm 37, the verse 3 is the kind of the launching point for this whole series that we have been in since the pandemic started on the faithfulness of God. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Do not fret. It only causes harm. For evildoers shall be cut off. But those who wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall be no more. Indeed, you will look carefully for his place, but it shall be no more. But the meek shall inherit the earth and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. The books of prophecy declared both his first coming and his second. The prophets foretold that Jesus, the Messiah, would be born in Bethlehem, which, while it was the ancestral home of David, was still just a small and almost insignificant place. They foretold the fact that he would be carried into Egypt, that somehow the Messiah would come out of Egypt, and that he would be raised in Nazareth and be called a Nazarene. They foretold about his life, about his death, about his resurrection. And then the Gospels tell us all about the fulfillment of all those things, how in the forbearance of God and in the divine counsel of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit had agreed together that one day the Messiah would come and he would be nailed upon a cross. And while he hung upon that cross, the sin of the entire world across time would be placed upon him. And he would bear that sin for all of us and pay the penalty once for all for fulfilling the prophecy and the picture of that wonderful day of atonement. And Jesus would die upon that cross, but on the third day, he rose from the dead. Then the letters take that glorious truth. They take that and they begin to apply it in practical ways to our lives, teaching us how to live, how to walk with Christ, how to be led by the Spirit. The letters extol the majesty of God while at the same time giving us specific instruction on following him. For instance, in Ephesians 3, it says, "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church." Folks, you realize every time we come together in this time of worship that we are coming for that noble purpose, that we gather together not just for our own edification, although that happens too, but that is not our primary purpose in coming. Our primary purpose in coming is to come that we may give glory to him in the church, that we may praise him and exalt him. My friend, when you're feeling a little bit low and you say, "I'm not sure I really feel like singing," remember your purpose here. Your purpose is to come and to give glory to God in the church and let your voice ring out. Don't worry about the quality of your tune. It's God that made your voice. It's God that made you just as you are. And if we will all sing out, if we will all forget ourselves and focus upon his majesty, upon what he has done in our life, for the way he has given us forgiveness and paid the penalty for our sin, to honor and glorify him and to have no other thought or purpose when we come together. How rich and meaningful our worship would be, not to us, But to him, have you ever thought that when we leave this place, you want God to look down from heaven and say, that was good. That was good. For God to be honored. You know, God senses when he's honored. God is pleased when he's praised. God delights in being exalted by his people. So do we want God to watch us leaving our time of worship and say, well, that was pretty so-so. We want God to say, I was honored in that. I was exalted by that. I was praised in that. And for the heart of God to be made glad by the praise of his people. That's what Paul said to the Ephesians. To him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Boy, that was weak. Forever and ever. Amen. 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 Let's give him glory. And then there's a consequence of doing that. The very next verse says, Therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling in which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness and long-suffering, bearing with one another in love. I'll tell you what, when our worship is filled with greater glory to the Lord, it'll help us when we go out there and we walk in this world and have to put up with each other. That's what he's talking about. Putting up with each other. Bearing with one another in love. And then the revelation comforts us with the certainty he is coming again and warns us to be ready. John said in Revelation 19, now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him is called faithful and true. And the armies of heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. See, I keep telling you that after we are raptured, and our soul and spirit goes to be with the Lord. We're given our glorified bodies. We stay in heaven. But at the end of the tribulation, when Christ comes back, we come with him. We make up the armies of heaven along with innumerable angels. Don't worry, we don't have to fight. Our commander-in-chief, he who is faithful and true, King of kings and Lord of lords, will with a single word from his mouth slay all the enemy, and they will fall down dead before us. We will not even lift a sword. He will win the battle, but we get to come back with him and delight in the victory. And then he begins to set up his kingdom to reign over the earth for 1,000 years. Glory, glory. Jesus is the way. He is the truth. And Jesus is the life. He is the one who offers eternal life to those who will trust in him. He is the resurrection life. He is the one who will give us ultimately a resurrection body like his own resurrection, glorified body. And my friend, he offers to each and every one of us abundant life. Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. Listen, the Lord does not want us living just a humdrum, get along day by day, do the best you can kind of life while we're here on this earth. He wants us living with purpose. He wants us living with intentionality. He wants us living in a way that honors Him and completes the purpose for which He caused us to be born and for which purpose He saved us. That's the abundant life that is filled with meaning and purpose. Life for God's purpose. Life with fulfillment that comes not from making lots of money, not by gaining lots of popularity, not by being exalted in the positions of men, none of those things being necessarily bad if it becomes a part of God's way, but none of those things being God's purpose. None of those things being what God has really got us here for. And the abundant life is living that life where we live out the purpose of God as He has it for us individually in our lives. And when we do that, life is filled with all kinds of fulfillment. Now I want to ask you a question. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, I don't want you to raise your hand on this, okay? But I want you to answer this question, and I want you to speak in your heart an answer to this to the Lord. I want the Lord to hear honestly from you. And that's why at this moment I'm not asking you to raise your hands about it. It's not about what others see. It's about what you say to the Lord. But I wonder how many of you that know the Lord, you're a believer, you're a follower of Christ, how many of you really want that kind of life? How many of you really want a life that is lived to its full for God's purpose? Not just for your own. Not just a life of fun and pleasure and earthly fulfillments. But you want to find a real fulfillment in life, because when you come to the end of life, you can say, I've done what God wanted me to do. I've completed what He put me on this earth for this short season of time. I'm going to live with Him forever, but for this season of time, He had a reason for me upon the earth, and I've lived it out to its fullness. I wonder how many really want that kind of life. Tell the Lord in your heart. Tell Him if you want that kind of life. Well, how can you have it? Friend, it's not complicated. And I'm going to remind you of what's necessary to have it, but it's not going to be anything new to you. It's not a secret. The number one thing about having that kind of life, a genuine, abundant life, and a life filled with meaning and God's purpose, is living continually being filled by the Spirit. Now, being filled by the Spirit, my friend, doesn't make you jump a pew and aren't you glad because these chair backs are a little bit tall. That's not what makes you jump a pew. Doesn't make you dance or speak in other tongues. Being filled with the Spirit means simply being empowered and controlled by the Holy Spirit. Now, I'll tell you what, sometime when we are filled with the Spirit, controlled by the Spirit, it'll impact the way we worship. It'll impact the faithfulness with which we read the Word of God. It'll impact our obedience to the Word of God. Paul said, don't be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. And the details of that text, when you study the Greek, it's saying, be continually filled every moment of every day, controlled and empowered by the Spirit. And when we do that, then we are growing in the likeness of Christ through sanctification. Sanctification means being made holy. And that's what Jesus prayed for. He said, sanctify them in your truth. Your word is truth. And so the sanctification is a work the Holy Spirit does in us as we are filled, controlled, and empowered by the Spirit. And he does it through the sufficiency of the Word of God. Now, the Bible may not tell you everything you want to know, but my friend, it'll tell you everything you need to know to live the abundant life, to live a life of meaning and purpose that ends in fulfillment because you have walked with God and you have fulfilled his purpose. This life is possible. My friend, this life can be had. If you said in your heart when I asked you that question, do you want this kind of life? Do you want the abundant life? Do you want to have a life filled and directed for God's purpose that when you come to the end of it, you can say, I have done what God put me here to do? If you said, I want that, You can have it. God is no respecter of persons. Any person can receive the gift of eternal life by trusting in Christ, and any person can have the abundant life here and now who has come to Christ and is a follower of Christ, who will be willing to be continually filled by the Spirit and will grow in the likeness of Christ through obedience to the Word. It works every time, and it works in every person who will do it. Listen, the only believers that don't live the abundant life, the only believers that die with their life purpose given by God unfulfilled are believers who don't want it, who will not do what has to be done, who are not willing to be controlled by the Spirit of God. They still want to do things their own way, who are not willing to spend time in the Word of God and to study the Word and know the Word and obey the Word and apply it to their life. Only those who refuse will not have it. It is available to all. My friend, let me tell you, it is available to every race. It is available to people of every age, from little children to senior adults. It is available to any gender. Listen, women, there's no glass ceiling here. You can be everything God designed you to be and purposed you to be, as much as any man could ever be, if you will just follow the Lord, controlled by the Spirit and obedient to the Word. And it is available to people of any past. Listen, when you come to Christ, he's the way to forgiveness. And all of your past can be forgiven. The slate can be wiped clean. And God can make you brand new and make you into the person that he wants you to be. It is available to any. And it is available to all who will receive it through Jesus, who is the way, the truth, the life. Stand with me. Let's pray. Every head bowed, every eye closed, please. I'm not asking you in this time not to look around at all. Make this just a personal, quiet time between you and the Lord, please. Now I want to ask you, is there anyone here today who would say to God, I really do want this abundant life, a life filled to its fullest with God's purpose? Now I'm going to ask you, if you'll make that commitment to God, to say, I really want it, And I'll do what the word says to do, to have it. Then I'm going to ask you to lift your hand to the Lord. Amen. I'm lifting mine. I want it. I want it. Don't look around. Just yourself. Amen. Put your hands down. Now, is there anyone here today who would say to God, I want that life, and I want eternal life, and I understand it's through Jesus, but I'm really not completely sure that I have it, but I want it, and I want to put my trust in Him. I know that's the beginning place. And I want to trust Him today. Would you just lift your hand? Amen. Anyone else? Would you just lift your hand? I'm not going to call on you. I'm not going to embarrass you. But I'm going to pray for you. Okay, you can put your hands down. If you want it, you want to put your trust in Jesus Christ, the beginning point, to receive eternal life, to receive forgiveness, to receive His righteousness. And it is the very first step towards having the abundant life. And right where you stand with head bowed, you pray this prayer with me. Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. And I need a Savior. I do believe You're God's Son. I believe You died for my sin. And I believe You rose from the dead. Jesus, today I repent of my sin. And I invite You to come into my life. I want You to be my Lord. My Master, my Savior. This day, I begin to follow You, Jesus. In Your name I pray. Amen. Amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer with me, as soon as we finish today, in just a few moments, I'm going to ask you to go over to the Next Steps desk over there and meet with our pastor, one of our pastors. And tell them what you've done, that you prayed that prayer with Brother Mike. They'll help you to know your very next step. Let's worship the Lord together.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless grace. To this I hope, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is hope. Overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
if you'll get this in.
Today we had the opportunity of having a time of dedication for our Operation Christmas Child Boxes. It's always a delight every year. I want to say thank you to all of you who helped pack these. We know that God uses these in mighty ways. So after our prayer of dedication, the children are going to bring boxes in and put them on display here for you to see, and let us continue to remember to pray for them during the week as they're distributed. Father, we love you so much, and God, we know that you orchestrate every detail of this mission of Operation Christmas Child. God, you care about these boxes because they open doors for the sharing of the gospel of Jesus. And so, Lord, I just pray that your hand will very clearly direct each individual box to exactly the right child who has a need in their life, and that need that they have for physical things would be encouraged, but God, even more, that their eyes would be opened as they realize that the source of this gift was a God who loves them very much. And we just pray that multiple thousands of kids will come to know Jesus even this year through these boxes. We give you praise for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
girls in many, many nations who will come to know Jesus. In every one of these boxes, a gospel message written for children that children can read and understand will be in the box where they can receive it. Plus, it'll be delivered by people who are sharing the gospel and by churches that they can connect to. So, glory to God. Amen? Amen. 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 Well, we get to end with lots of celebration. I'm going to ask Jennifer Strickland to step up here. Back in April, while we were all locked down and shut up, Jennifer came to her 20th anniversary as a staff member in our church. Hallelujah. I tell you what, 20 years is a long time, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, I started to say something along that line, but I thought, no matter what you say, this won't come out right. So I'm glad you did that instead of me trying. But in all of her 20 years here, she has actually served our church in multiple roles. So she knows what being a ministry assistant is like in a lot of places. But for nearly 15 years now, she has been my ministry assistant. Now, that I know elicits sympathy. I hope it will cause you to pray all the more for her as a God bless her heart with what she must have to put up with all week long. So, but Jennifer, we are so grateful to you. Let me tell you, I do get to observe Jennifer's work very up close. And I'll tell you, Jennifer is so efficient. She is faithful. She's cooperative, willing, always does her work as unto the Lord, not just as unto a pastor, but as unto the Lord, making sure that she can give her very best as an offering that's pleasing to the Lord. Jennifer, our church has a gift for you. We want to just celebrate your 20 years with you. We're thankful for you. God bless you. Just remain standing, okay? On your way out, if you desire to give, there are giving stations. You can give by text or you can give online. I think most of you are familiar with that. We're grateful to the Lord for the way that you give back to Him. And in so doing, you support the work and life and ministry. It's the purpose of our church in taking the gospel throughout this community and around the world. And Lord, today, we honor and bless your name. We tell you there is none like you, and we worship you. Great Almighty, full of power, full of wisdom, full of mercy, full of love. Thank you for all that you do for us, but more than anything, thank you that Jesus paid the price for us in dying upon the cross, that we might have life in His name, that we can have life to the fullest in His name as well. Amen.